Blackstone presents Witch Wood by John Buchan. This book is read by Antony Ferguson. And Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, and removed all the idols that his fathers had made. But the high places were not removed. First Book of Kings, chapter 15, verses 11 through 14. Prologue. Time, my grandfather used to say, stood still in that glen of his. But the truth of the saying did not survive his death, and the first daisies had scarcely withered on his grave before a new world was knocking at the gate. That was 30 years ago, and today the revolution is complete. The parish name has been changed. The white box of a kirk, which served the glen for more than 2 centuries, has been rebuilt in red suburban Gothic. A main railway line now runs down the Aller, and the excellent summer service brings holidaymakers from 100 miles distant. Houses and shops have clustered under the Hill of Deer. There may be found a well-reputed boarding school for youth, 2 inns, both of them reformed, a garage, and a bank agent. The center of importance has moved from the old village to the new town by the station. And even the old village is no more than a clacken of thatched roofs straggling by a burnside. Some enemy of the human race has taught the burn to run straight like a sewer, and has spanned it with a concrete bridge, while the thatch of the houses has been replaced by slates of a metallic green. Only the ruins of the old Kirkton have not been meddled with. These stand as I remember them, knee-deep in docks and nettles, defended by a crumbling dry stone dike against inquisitive cattle from Crossbasket. The old folk are gone too, and their very names are passing from the countryside. Long before my day, the Hawkshaws had disappeared from Caledon, but there was a respectable Edinburgh Burgess family who had come there in the 17th century. Now these have given place to a rawer Burgess graft from the west. The farmers are mostly new men, and even the peasant, who should be the enduring stock, has shifted his slow bones. I learned from the postman that in Wooderley today there was no Montfries, no Sprott, but 1 Pennycuick, and only 2 bearers of the names of Richie and Shillinglaw, which had once been plentiful as ragwort. In such a renovated world, it was idle to hope to find surviving the tales which had perplexed my childhood. No one could tell me when or why the kirk by the Crossbasket March became a ruin, and its gravestones lay buried in weeds. Most did not even know that it had been a kirk. I was not greatly surprised by this, for the kirk of Wooderley had not been used for the better part of 3 centuries, and even as a child I could not find many to tell me of its last minister. The thing had sunk from a tale to an o'ercome, a form of words which everyone knew, but which few could interpret. It was Jess Blaine, the Grieve's daughter, who first stirred my curiosity. In a whirl of wrath at some of my doings, she prayed that the fate of the minister of Wooderley might be mine, a fate which she expounded as to be clot by the deal and a wee-wee. A little scared, I carried the affair to my nurse, who was gravely scandalized, and denounced Jess as a shameful toppy, flying the ween's mind wi' her black lees. Dinna you be feared, dearie, she reassured me. It wasna the deil that come for the minister o' Wooderley. I've aye heard tell that he was a good man and a kind man. It was the fairies, hinny, and he lived happy with them and deed happy, and never drank out on an empty cup. I took my information, I remember, to the clan of children who were my playmates, and they spread it among their households, and came back with confirmation or contradiction. Some held for the devil, some for the fairies, a proof that tradition spoke with 2 voices. The fairy school slightly outnumbered the others, and in a battle 1 April evening, close to the ruined kirk, we routed the diabolists and established our version as the canon. But save for that solitary fact, that the minister of Wooderley had gone off with the fairies, the canon remained bare. Years later I got the tale out of many books and places, a folio in the library of a Dutch college, the muniment room of a Catholic family in Lancashire, notes in a copy of the second Latin edition of Wishart's Montrose, the diaries of a captain of Hebron's and of a London glovemaker, the exercise book of a 17th-century Welsh schoolgirl. I could piece the story together well enough, but at first I found it hard to fit into the Woodley that I knew. That decorous landscape, prim, determinate, without a hint of mystery. The bare hilltops, bleak at seasons, but commonly of a friendly Pickwickian boldness, skirted with methodically planned woods of selected conifers and girdled with mathematical stone dikes. The even, ruled fields of the valley bottom. The studied moderation of the burns in a land meticulously drained. The dapper glass and stone and metal of the village. 2 miles off, it was true, ran the noble untamed streams of Alla. Beyond them, the hills rose in dark fields to mid-sky, with the glen of the Rood making a sword cut into their heart. But Woodley itself, whither had fled the savour? Once, I knew from the books, the great wood of Melanudrigill had descended from the heights and flowed in black waves to the village brink. But I could not recreate the picture out of glistening asphalted highway, singing telegraph wires, spruce dwellings, model pastures, and manicured woodlands. Then one evening, from the Hill of Deer, I saw with other eyes. There was a curious leaden sky, with a blue break about sunset, so that the shadows lay oddly. My first thought, as I looked at the familiar scene, was that, had I been a general in a campaign, I should have taken special note of Woodley, for it was a point of vantage. It lay right in the pass between the Scottish Midlands and the South. The pass of road and water, yes, and, shall I say, of spirit. For it was in the throat of the hills, on the march between the Sown and the desert. I was looking east, and to my left and behind me the open downs, farmed to their last decimal of capacity, were the ancient land of Manon, the capital province of Pictum. The colliery headgear on the horizon, the trivial Moorish hilltops, the dam-broad pattern fields, could never tame wholly for me that land's romance, and on this evening I seemed to be gazing at a thing antique and wolfish, tricked out for the moment with a sheep's coat. To my right rose the huddle of great hills which cradle all our rivers. To them time and weather bring little change, yet in that eerie light, which revealed in hard outline while it obscured in detail, they seemed too remote and awful to be the kindly giants with whose glens I daily conversed. At my feet lay Woodley, and a miracle had been wrought.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.